It's seldom that I read obituaries, but one day on the drive to downtown Columbus, obituary on the front page of the New York Times caught my eye. And after I read the obituary, I knew that it was what I need to convey on this very special day. The smoke was rising as Rabbi Herschel Schachter rode through the gates of Buchenwald. It was April 11, 1945, and General George S. Patton's Third Army had liberated the concentration camp scarcely an hour before. Rabbi Schachter, who was attached to the Third Army's Eighth Corps, was the first Jewish chaplain to enter in its wake. That morning, after learning that Patton's forward tanks had arrived at the camp, Rabbi Schachter, who died in the Riverdale section of the Bronx on Thursday at 95, after a career as one of the most prominent modern Orthodox rabbis in the United States, commandeered a Jeep and a driver. He left headquarters and sped towards Buchenwald. By late afternoon, when the rabbi drove through the gates, Allied tanks had breached the camp. He remembered, he said later, the sting of smoke in his eyes, the smell of burning flesh, and the hundreds of bodies strewn everywhere. He would remain at Buchenwald for months, tending to survivors, leading religious services in a former Nazi recreation hall, and eventually helping to resettle thousands of Jews. In Buchenwald that April day, Rabbi Schachter said afterward, "It seemed as though there was no one left alive." In the camp, he encountered a young American lieutenant who knew his way around. "Are there any Jews alive here?" the rabbi asked him. He was led to the Klein Lager, or little camp, a smaller camp within a larger one. There, in filthy barracks, men lay on raw wooden planks, stacked from floor to ceiling. They stared down at the rabbi in his unfamiliar military uniform with unmistakable fright. "Shalom, Alakim, Yidden," Rabbi Schachter cried in Yiddish, "Er zin frei. Peace be upon you, Jews, you are free." He ran from barracks to barracks, repeating those words. He was joined by those Jews who could walk until a stream of people swelled behind him. As he passed a mound of corpses, Rabbi Schachter spied a flicker of movement. Drawing closer, he saw a small boy, prisoner 17,030, hiding in terror behind the mound. "I was afraid of him," the child would long recall afterwards in an interview with the New York Times. "I knew all of the uniforms of the SS, the Gestapo, Wehrmacht, and all of a sudden, a new kind of uniform. I thought, a new kind of enemy." With tears streaming down his face, Rabbi Schachter picked the boy up. "What's your name, my child?" he asked in Yiddish. "Lulik," the child replied. "How old are you?" the rabbi asked. "What difference does it make?" Lulik, who was seven, he said, "I'm older than you anyway." "Why do you think you're older?" Rabbi Schachter asked, smiling. "Because you cry and laugh like a child," Lulek, the seven-year-old, replied. "I haven't laughed in a long time, and I don't even cry anymore. So which one of us is older? Rabbi Schachter discovered nearly 1,000 orphan children in Buchenwald. He and a colleague, Rabbi Robert Marcus, helped arrange for their transport to France, a convoy that included Lulek and the teenage Elie Wiesel, as well as to Switzerland, a group personally conveyed by Robert Schachter and to Palestine. For decades afterwards, Rabbi Schachter said he remained haunted by his time in Buchenwald and by the questions survivors put to him as he raced through the camp that first day. They were asking me over and over, "Does the world know what happened to us?" Rabbi Schachter told the Associated Press in 1981. This is why we are building a Holocaust memorial on the grounds of this statehouse, so no one will ever forget.